So, good afternoon. My name is Antonio Porto. I teach at the Informatics Engineering Department here at ISEP, and I've been the responsible for the capstone unit in the almost 10 years. So it's a lot of time and a lot of interesting things happened during these 10 years. Until 2008, I was the program director. Nowadays, I'm mainly focused on the capstone curricular unit. So basically, from my experience and the experience of the program, we have been producing an ecosystem for the management of the program, in which the capstone plays a very important part here. So basically, this is our ecosystem, and you can see that, of course, we have the curricular units, but the units are integrated into processes. Then we have feedbacks and inputs, and of course, we produce graduates, and these graduates basically interact with employers, and we use social networks to make some interaction and to learn about what the graduates are doing, and of course this also comes here to the society, and of course we do the professional accreditation of the program by the Professional Engineering Association in Portugal and by INAI in Europe, and of course this also has impact on the application grades and the students that want to come to our program here at ISEP. And basically, we have been developing and refining this ecosystem, and it is very gratifying to say that this is a very interesting way to get the big picture around the program. So some small details. So basically, our informatics engineering program nowadays is the biggest bachelor degree in Portugal. We enroll more than 300 students, and we have more than 1,020 students at this program. And for the current curricular year, we had more than 1,000 candidates for 20 and 10 slots, which is a very interesting ratio. So, and what's behind this experience of running successful projects with enterprises? So basically, I will go back and tell you a quick story. So in 2007, it was mandatory in Portugal to transform the programs and adapt them to the Bologna process. And we also took the initiative to see, okay, our program is running nice, but we can do better, of course. And so we looked for good practices or good frameworks that we could use and shape and change the program. And it was instrumental, the option for the CDIO initiative. Basically, it's a CDIO was developed just to answer some scientific drift that happened during the 60s, 70s, and the 80s, in which engineering, teaching of engineering, drift into too much science and too few practice. And so basically, some people from MIT and three Swedish universities tried to reverse the process and then reinforce the importance of the practice into the engineering programs. And that was the concept behind CDIO. So basically, scenario means conceive, design, implement, and operate. Things that any engineer must do very well. Okay? And this was the emphasis. So this CDIU initiative basically uses this statement as its need. We need to do this, and students must be largely experienced in doing conceive, design, implement, operate. And of course, the objectives are very reasonable. So increase the deeper working knowledge of students, make them be able to lead creation and operation of things, and to educate them into the importance and strategic impact of research and development on society in general. CDIO initiative also produced a lot of documents, open source documents that anybody can use, and you don't have to say that the document comes from CDIO, but basically they decided to adopt 12 standards of good practice, which help a lot if somebody wants to adopt CDIO and put it into practice. And these are the 12 standards of good practice, in which those that are at bold are the primary ones, the most important, and the non, and the others are important but not as the others. And this good practice can also be seen a key performance indicators. So you can evaluate this on a 3-year basis or 5-year basis, and then you can see, okay, I'm improving here, I'm going down in some of these, and then you can take corrective action. So basically, this is also very important, to use these practices as performance indicators. One of the important aspects at CDIO is that it provides a generic syllabus that can be used, which is very, very well structured, and it can be easily adapted to any specific engineering discipline, even outside of engineering. So basically, the syllabus proposes that each student must reach some proficiency level, first in the disciplinary knowledge and reasoning, also at personal and professional skills and attributes. And you can see that there are sections in each of these brief topics, and also at interpersonal skills, teamwork and communication, and finally the engineering skills. So this is basically the engineering skill in which CDIO is important. In reality, the generic syllabus has 4 levels. I'm showing only the first 2, so you can anticipate that there is a lot of detail in writing these syllabus for some specific engineering program. And typically, the outcomes are described at the 4th level, and usually people tend to use Bloom Cognitive Scale or something like that. In the case of our informatics engineering program, in 2006-07, it was decided to change the way the program worked. So basically, nowadays we have 12 weeks with conventional integrated courses, and then 4 weeks just for a project-based learning experience during 5 semesters. And in the end, in the last semester, we have the capstone project, typically with internship, and also three auxiliary courses that we can shape, and that will be changing this curricula here. And basically, they give support to the project internship. And this has been very successful experience, and the program has improved a lot when we decided to change to this architecture. One of the important things of adopting such a highly structured initiative is that it is important to integrate the learning process. So courses are no more standalone. This is not. A course does not belong to the teacher, belongs to the program. Okay? So basically, one effort that we decided to pursue is, okay, how can we say that there is some path from the beginning to the end, and what is the contribution of the courses, of relevant courses to this path? And basically nowadays we have mostly two integrated processes. One is mostly dedicated to software engineering learning process, and the other is more general about computing. I'm showing only this as an example. And you can see that most of the courses contribute more or less to this path. And this is very good to keep a big picture of what's happening to the courses and their contributions to the program. Some relevant consequences of adopting CDIO. So basically we have a syllabus with very much detail, can be analyzed in four levels. It depends on the person that wants to know about it. It also helped to define and update the learning processes and keep them aligned with the syllabus. The courses tend to develop personal, interpersonal, social, and engineering skills, and this is also very important. Faculty is more involved and more responsible and cares a lot more with the management of the courses. And there is an emphasis on learning over teaching. We have also the opportunity to collect extensive feedback about the program and its outcomes in the context of capstone internship projects and activities. And this is also very important because we must listen to people that get our graduates. And even if we don't agree with them sometimes, but even so we must take care and listen to their opinions. One example of using the standards as a way to analyze the progress is this example. For instance, in 2009, the first time that we decided to analyze how the program was working in terms of the 12 best good practices, we had this course, scaling from 0 to 5, and of course, it was very incipient. There was even a 0. And 3 years later, we have improved. And in 2015, or in the beginning of next year, we will also reanalyze the program and try to see if there has been any relevant improvement in these best practices. And it is interesting to see that typically, on a worldwide scale, typically standard 9 and 10 are the worst. Even at MIT, Stanford, and everywhere, everybody complains about the same. That enhancing the faculty skills competence and enhancing the faculty teaching competence is difficult. Okay, sometimes the teachers are very resistant to this. And although some improvement has happened, it is clearly under the other achievement on the other best practices. So there is still a lot to be done here. Okay? And it's not only a problem with teachers, but also with management, with students, and so on. But it's a challenge that we are still trying to address and improve. In terms of performance, the capstone internship is nowadays a very important course in our program, and I can show some results. For instance, in this last year, 2014-15, we had 417 approved projects from external and mostly external organizations, also projects submitted by research institutions or personal projects from the students, and from these 417, 227 were assigned to students. We also nowadays note that there is very high student and graduate employability. The number of students that start to work during the program has increased, and that is good, but eventually it can become a problem. There is increased interaction between employers and the program, and this also was very important in achieving this European certification, the EURACE quality seal, in 2003 for 6 years. And it was the first Portuguese engineering bachelor to achieve this European quality seal.
1 minute.
Okay. So basically, so we are using a lot of instruments, which I will not detail, you can see on the paper. It is very important for us to collect feedback from teachers, the advisors, from external supervisors, and this is instrumental so that we can improve things. Okay? In our case, each student, individually or within a group, has to defend the solution produced between a jury involving people from the program and people from outside. And you can see that the project is 50% and the documentation is 50%. For us, the documentation is critical. If you do something and you cannot explain what you have done, you're not an engineer. So that's why we give so much weight to the technical report aspect. We can see that grades are interesting. We have had some 20s during these last years. We also are able, using CDIO, to profile the students and replace the grade point average with a set of 3 descriptors. And eventually, we can see that most of our students are, and you can see the letters, BCC, means most of our students are very good at competence, are good at capacity, and are good at knowledge, which is this bar. And this is interesting, because we should direct our efforts to improve this and get them onto the left side of the picture. It is also important to say that we collect a lot of feedback from the advisors and external supervisors, and then allows us to analyze the performance of students in terms of soft skills, like for instance time management, deadline fulfillment, and so on. And we can see that things are more or less stable, but there is a very large margin of improvement for this. So we must insist on improving this. So finally, so this was our ecosystem, and the importance of accreditation or certification is very relevant. Okay? Because basically, once some credible organization comes and says that our students are good, this typically has impact on society and typically has impact on education grade. So the last slide is just saying the same thing. So, the importance of having professional certification, in our case with EURACE. And it's important to notice that these certifications take some time to reach the society, but when they reach, basically it makes a difference. Okay? So thank you very much for your attention.